Next, we have with us Dr. Malcolm Jeyaraj, sir. Sir is a senior assistant professor of neurology at Stanley Medical College, Chennai. He did his MD in general medicine from Tirunelveli Medical College and had done his DM in neurology from Stanley Medical College, Chennai. He had done his postdoctoral fellowship in epilepsy from Sri Chitra Thirunal Institute at Trivandrum. His various areas of interest include evaluation of drug refractory epilepsy in patients, video EEG, epilepsy surgery, intraoperative neuromonitoring. He is a member of IAN, IEA, IES, and ISA. Sir has around 15 articles in peer-reviewed journals and 2 book chapters. Sir would be here giving us his valuable insights on the topic neurology case discussion, imaging, and EEG. Thank you, sir. On to you, sir.
Morning to all, and shall I start?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
I will be presenting short case vignettes of almost typical patients who would be examined from the examination point of view. I've got around 5 cases. I would like to interact with one of the postgraduates. I will run through the case. And as in neurological discussion, based on localization or phenomenology or combination of both, the student would have to localize or lateralize and come to a conclusion. And I will help them out. Please go ahead, sir. So my first patient is a 65-year-old gentleman whose chief complaints are slowness of activities of daily living for 2 years. He has a tremulousness in the right hand, which is followed by the left hand. The tremor is largely a rest tremor for the past 1 year. He's been having sleep disturbances in the form of delayed onset and fragmentation of the sleep for the past 6 months. Next slide. However, he has not had any history of frequent falls. There's no history of dizziness or sudden getting up, bowel or bladder disturbances. There is no history of unsteadiness of gait, clumsiness of limbs. There's no history of any abnormal posturing, no history of memory disturbances, hallucinations, fluctuations of symptoms, no history of chronic drug intake. Next slide, please. On examination, the BP is around 130 by 80 in supine. There's no postural drop. There's hypomimia. There's a low volume monotonous speech. There's a bilateral bradykinesia. He's having a resting hand tremor. A cogwheel rigidity, which is there, the right more than left. He's got a flexed posture and gait, short shuffling steps, reduced arm swing, turns and block. Next slide. Can I have someone to discuss? Am I audible, sir?
Hello?
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Morning, sir. I'm Dr. Ashwin Shashiran, currently pursuing my second year post-graduation in MD Psychiatry.
Good morning.
Sir. Yes, sir. Regarding this case, I'll from the chief complaints itself, we've got an asymmetrical involvement of resting tremor along with bradykinesia, and also in chief complaints, we're able to get the history of initial and middle insomnia. All these point towards from the chief complaints itself, it points towards the diagnosis of idiopathic Parkinson's disease, sir. And in the negative history, we have ruled out the possibility of other atypical Parkinsonism like progressive supranuclear palsy, multisystem atrophy, and also we have ruled out the dementia of Lewy body and the possibility for secondary causes of Parkinsonism. And on examination finding, it revealed all the cardinal features of idiopathic Parkinson's disease, including asymmetrical cogwheel rigidity, flexed posture with short shuffling gait, and bradykinesia and resting tremor. From the above findings, the diagnosis of idiopathic Parkinson's disease would be a first diagnosis. The diagnosis can be made, sir.
A very excellent discussion, Ashwin.
Thank you, sir.
I mean, the diagnosis is evident here. It is a case of an idiopathic Parkinson's disease.
Sir.
But in the case of an examination where we are asked to present this case, the way we take it forward is something like this. So here we have a patient who's got a bradykinesia, a resting tremor, which is asymmetrical, and there's the rigidity. And as you said, the red flag signs for Parkinson's are not present here. So how do we localize this? Here you do a localization first. So where do we take it is, the issue seems to be in the basal ganglia. And in the basal ganglia, it is found to be more in the left than in the right. So a case of a bilateral basal ganglionic disease, which is asymmetrical and which has got classic features without any red flag signs, and hence it is a case of an idiopathic Parkinson's disease. That's how you put it in the exam. Okay, thank you.
Okay, sir.
The next one. Here there is a 60-year-old gentleman who's got slowness of activities of daily living for 1 year, frequent backward falls for the past 6 months. There is no history of tremor. There's no history of dizziness of sudden getting up or bladder or bowel disturbances. There is no history of unsteadiness of gait, clumsiness of limbs, no history of any abnormal limb posturing. There's no history of memory disturbances, hallucinations, fluctuations of symptoms, no chronic drug toxin exposure or encephalitis. Next slide, please. This BP is 150 by 80 on supine posture. There is no postural drop. A hypomimia is found. A low volume monotonous speech. There is a vertical gaze restriction which is present. There is a bilateral bradykinesia and cogwheel rigidity present. The axial rigidity is more than the limb rigidity. On examination, there is no tremor. He's got slow, short steps. The arm swing is reduced bilaterally. He turns en bloc, and a severe postural instability is present.
Yes, there are students in the chat box who already answered, sir.
One of them
is able to say that like it's progressive supraclavicular palsy.
I mean, very good, sir. I mean, they have identified the diagnosis, but I would like the discussion to discuss this case from the examination point of view.
Okay, sir. So from the chief complaints, the characteristic finding of early backward falls of progressive supranuclear palsy is obtained from the clinical from the patient's chief complaints, and from the negative history we have ruled out all the possibilities of other atypical Parkinsonism, secondary Parkinsonism, and dementia of Lewy body. And on examination of the patient, it revealed up gaze palsy and symmetrical cogwheel rigidity, which are features of PSP, and also other features of progressive supranuclear palsy like axial rigidity greater than limb rigidity and presence of severe postural instability. Along with all the other features of Parkinsonism, we can narrow down the diagnosis to progressive supranuclear palsy, sir.
Very good. Told by Mr. Dr. Ashwin, is rightly identified. Here in this case, a case of a Parkinsonism, the crucial points here are symmetrical Parkinson's, there's not much of tremor, there is a vertical gaze restriction, there is a early falls, and in fact, in some of the patients, you will have a dysarthria in the form of words running into another, and a postural instability on examination. All these suggest an atypical Parkinson, likely with PSP as the first diagnosis. The next case. Here, I am presenting a 60-year-old gentleman with chief complaints of slowness of activities of daily living for 1 year, sleep disturbances for 6 months in the form of vocalizations, limb movements like punching, kicking during sleep. Can I ask the discussant, what is this due to?
So these are suggestive of the sleep disturbances, which is characterized by vocalization, limb movements like punching, kicking, are all suggestive of what is called as REM sleep behavioral disorders, which is a characteristic feature of Parkinson's disease, and also it can be seen in atypical Parkinsonism also, sir.
Atypical Parkinson's, do you see RBD?
Pardon, sir?
Which atypical Parkinson's do you see RBD?
We can see mostly in progressive supranuclear palsy and also in MSC, also multisystem atrophy, it is mostly seen, sir.
Progressive supranuclear palsy, do you see RBD? Do you see encephalopathies or entopathies?
Okay, sir. Mostly it will be seen in multisystem atrophy, sir. It will be in alpha synuclein deposition, sir. Mostly.
So you see it in synucleopathies.
Synucleopathies, sir.
What are the synucleopathies you know of?
Synucleopathies, dementia of Lewy body is one synucleopathy, multisystem atrophy, and Parkinson's disease, sir.
Yes.
Idiopathic Parkinson's.
So PSP, you do not get a REM sleep behavioral disorder. PSP is just the autopathy. Right.
Okay, sir.
So the patient has got also bladder and bowel dysfunctions and in the form of urinary incontinence and erectile dysfunction. Can I move to the next slide? There is no tremor. There is no history of abnormal posturing, no history of memory disturbances, hallucinations, fluctuations of symptoms, no history of chronic drug or toxin exposure or encephalitis. Next slide. On examination, the BP is 150 by 80 in the supine posture and 110 by 60 on 3 minutes standing. There is a hypomimia. There is a dyspnea. There is extraocular movements are normal. It's a symmetrical Parkinson. There is no tremor. In cerebellar examination, finger nose test and heel knee test are intact. Stance and gait ataxia are present. There is a camptocomia and antrocolis. What is camptocomia, doctor?
Camptocomia, it is an abnormal thoracolumbar spinal flexion. The thoracolumbar spinal flexion will be abnormally. Sir.
Exactly. In which condition is camptocomia seen?
Camptocomia is typical of multiple
Parkinson's, atrophy. Rather.
A typical Parkinson's, it is seen in multisystem atrophy, sir.
Camptocomia is a forward flexion. I saw in the messages the PISA sign. PISA sign is lateral. So, this is forward bending. So, these are seen in MSAs. Okay. So, can you discuss this case now?
Okay, sir. Here, the patient's chief complaints itself, it revealed the presence of autonomic dysfunction as evident by the presence of bowel and bladder disturbances and along with other symptoms of Parkinsonism, including that suggestive of REM sleep behavioral disorders. History is suggestive of multisystem atrophy, which is coming under atypical Parkinsonism. And like previous case, we have ruled out the possibility for the atypical Parkinsonism, secondary causes of Parkinsonism, and DLB, dementia of Lewy body. And on examination of the patient, it revealed distinguishing features of multisystem atrophy, which includes postural hypotension, dysphonia, androcolis, and captocornea, along with other features of Parkinson's. And predominant involvement of cerebellum, as evident from deranged cerebellar test, it favors the diagnosis of multisystem atrophy cerebellar types.
Can I ask you a question, doctor?
Sir,
why can't this be a case of a spinocerebellar atrophy?
There is no history of weakness, sir, in the patient. He's not coming out with any.
Atrophy need not have a weakness.
Okay, sir.
Yes, the age of onset is slightly delayed. I agree that's a point. But what is the core feature that tells that this is unlikely to be a case of spinocerebellar atrophy? Sensory signs are generally not seen in spinocerebellar atrophy.
Okay, sir.
There is one distinguishing feature. If you identify and tell, sir, that tells it goes away from spinocerebellar atrophy.
The eye movement changes. There is no history of.
No, sir. The eye movement is not there. The autonomic features.
Sir. That is most in favor of this diagnosis.
So generally, the autonomic features are not considered as a part of spinocerebellar atrophy. So this is a case of a Parkinson, a symmetrical Parkinson with autonomic involvement, and also there is a dysphonia. there is a history of RPD, and there are classical cerebellar signs which suggest that this is a multisystem atrophy cerebellar variant, MSA C type. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Can I have the next slide? So I've just, from the exam point of view, just conglomerated the core features to differentiate between PD, PSP, MSA, and DLB. I'll go through one by one. So in the resting stroma is largely seen in PE, rarely seen in MSA and DLB, never seen in PSP. An action tremor is generally not seen in any of these variants. Regarding symmetry, symmetry is a very important finding. As Dr. Ashwin had earlier remarked, asymmetricity is a rank feature of PD, while PSP, MSA, and DLB are symmetric in nature. Okay. Axial dystonia is seen in PSP, while also seen in MSA in the form of camptocomia as well as in a PISA sign. Gaze palsy is a distinguishing feature for PSP. Backward falls is especially a characteristic feature of PSP, while not seen in any of the other. Autonomic dysfunction is a characteristic feature of MSA. Cerebellar signs may or may not be present in MSA depending on whether it's an MSA C or P or A variant. It's largely seen in C. Next slide. Next slide. Dementia in an early phase is seen in DLB. RBD as a feature is seen in all the synucleopathies. Visual hallucinations are seen in DLB. Fluctuations of symptoms are noted in DLB. And the response to levodopa is best with PD. I hope I have summarized the Parkinsonian component. Can we go on to the next case?
Okay, sir.
Now I'm talking to you on a 60-year-old gentleman who is a male, who is a diabetic, who is hypertensive and a smoker. The chief complaints are sudden onset weakness of the right upper and lower limb for the past 5 days, associated with inability to speak. His consciousness is oriented, his BP is 170-90. His speech is non-fluent. His comprehension is intact. He has got a right human facial palsy. Power is 2/5 in the right upper and lower limbs. Spasticity and hyperreflexia. Next slide. The plantar is extensor on the right, flexor on the left. Sensations are impaired over the right half of the body. No cerebellar or extrapyramidal deficits. Yes.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. In this case, the chief complaints actually reveals it reveals the presence of vascular risk factors like type 2 diabetes, systemic hypertension.
Can I just we go from the as we do it in a normal examination?
Oh yes, sure, sir. Sure, sir.
You localize.
Oh yes, sure, sir.
Tell the structures that are involved, and then go into the etiology.
Oh yes, sir. Here the patient presented with acute onset of weakness. So the acuteness of event point towards because he presented with right-sided weakness and with spasticity and hyperreflexia, it points towards an upper motor neuron type of weakness of right upper limb and lower limb, sir. And also right UMN type of facial palsy he presented with. And along with that, the speech, which is non-fluent with intact comprehension, point towards Broca's aphasia. And on examination also, it revealed hemisensory involvement of right side of body. These clinical features, along with the presence of vascular risk factors.
Intervene here, Dr. Ashwin. You have to mention the structures involved first.
Okay, sir.
So you mentioned Broca's area, where is the Broca's area?
Yeah, Broca's area is area number, it is in the inferior frontal gyrus, sir.
Inferior frontal gyrus on the right side or the left side? Or the dominant side or the non-dominant side?
It is in the dominant side, sir.
Very good.
Yes, sir. Dominant side, sir. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. Area number 44, sir. Okay, sir. So, Broca's area
is the second structure that is involved.
Second structure, which is involved, is the motor area is also involved, sir. The motor area of the person is also involved, sir? Primary motor area.
Which tract is involved?
Corticospinal tract is a tract which is involved, sir.
Right side or left side?
The patient presented with, sir, the, one second, sir.
So the patient presents with the right side weakness.
Yes, sir.
Spasticity on the right side. There is hyperreflexia and the plantar is extensor on the right side.
So right side is weak, sir.
Corticospinal tract.
Left is involved, sir.
So where in the left side it is involved?
Yes, sir. We can either localize the lesion to internal capsule or we can, if we are actually localizing the lesion to the internal capsule, we cannot explain the Broca's involved.
Why are you localizing it to the internal capsule?
Because of the weakness, we can think of the involvement of internal capsule, but because of the Broca's involvement and hemisensory involvement, we cannot do that, sir. We cannot localize the lesion to internal capsule, sir.
Can I just add a point here?
Sir?
Can I add a point?
Oh, yes, sir. Sure, sir.
See, I mean, right, we say that the left side of the left corticospinal tract is involved.
Sir.
And how do we further localize it is, there is a right human facial weakness. That means it can be anywhere above the level of pons.
Okay, sir.
It could be the midbrain. It could be the capsule. It could be in the corona radiator. It could be in the cortex. All right.
Oh, okay, sir.
So here, the next point for us to tell regarding the localization is, since the Broca's is involved,
sir,
most likely the corticospinal tract would be involved in the more in the cortical area rather than the sensory. Okay, that's how we are.
Okay, sir.
Point is, the sensory is also involved. Since the motor cortex is involved, infrafrontal gyrus is also involved. It's also likely to be either in the sensory strip or in the thalamus. One more point which should have been added is regarding cortical sensation. But cortical sensation, we cannot comment when there is a primary sensory loss which is there.
Okay, so, okay, understood, sir.
So we say that it's a motor cortex, probably the sensory strip and the inferior frontal gyrus which is involved. And the patient has had an acute event all of a sudden. It suggests that it is likely to be a vascular event. And he has got vascular risk factors in the form of diabetes, hypertension, and smoking. Sir. And hence, we think that most likely it is going to be a stroke. And the stroke most likely is likely to be in the inferior MCA territory. And where in the MCA territory? It's in the superior division of the middle cerebral artery.
Cortical branch, sir.
It supplies all of these.
So
it's a MCA territory stroke of the superior division, which is resulting in a right hemiparesis with Broca's aphasia with a hemisensory.
Oh, yes. Understood, sir.
Next. So, this is my last case. This is a 70-year-old gentleman who's a diabetic, who's a hypertensive, who's a smoker. And his chief complaints are sudden onset, vertigo, vomiting, difficulty in swallowing with nasal regurgitation, unsteadiness of gait with the tendency to fall towards the left side since one day. So he's got three issues. One is vertigo and vomiting, a difficulty in swallowing with the nasal regurgitation, and unsteadiness of gait with the tendency to fall towards the left side. Yeah, next slide. Yeah, on examination, he's conscious, he's oriented, his BP is 150/90. The left eye, there is a partial ptosis and meiosis which is present. The uvula deviates to the right side. The gag reflex is diminished on the left side. Power is well preserved. Next slide, please. Plantar is a bilateral flexor. Pain and temperature are impaired over the left half face and right half of the body. Cerebellar functions are impaired on the left side. Stance and gait ataxia are present. And tandem walking is impaired. Yes. Yes, doctor.
Yes, sir. Here in this case, the chief complaints include vertigo and vomiting. So it point towards involvement of vestibular cochlear nerve and its connection. And next, his presenting complaint is difficulty in swallowing with nasal regurgitation. It shows involvement of glossopharyngeal and vagus cranial nerves. And tendency to fall towards the left side shows the involvement of left cerebellum and its connections. But on examination of the patient, it revealed left ptosis and meiosis. It indicates involvement. It indicates the diagnosis of left-sided Ehlers. Ehlers syndrome is present. Okay. And involvement, the deviation of duvula is also present to the right side. It points to the involvement of left-sided glossopharyngeal and vagus cranial nerves involvement. And on examination of the GAG reflex, it is diminished. So this indicates a lower motor neuron type of 9 and 10 cranial nerve involvement. And also on examination, it revealed pain and temperature impairment over the left half of face, which shows involvement of the left trigeminal nerve involvement, and pain and temperature is impaired on the right half of the body also. It shows involvement of left spinothalamic tract. Regarding the cerebellar tests, it is impaired on the left sided. All the cerebellar the left sided cerebellar tests are all impaired. It shows involvement of left cerebellum and its connections. So all the above findings, which are all characteristic of the condition, which is called as lateral medullary syndrome. The lateral part of the medulla is involved, which is a causative factor for all the presenting complaint, and also it explains all the examination findings, sir.
Agreed. I mean, you've discussed it very well, Dr. Ashwin.
Sir, thank you, sir.
The point here is, it is not the nerves that are involved. The popliteal nerve, it is not,
okay.
It's not the vagus nerve, but okay. It is the nucleus. Nucleus of these nerves that are involved. Because once you say it's a nerve, we say it's extraxial. Here we are talking about something that is intraxial.
So, intraxial.
Nuclei or the fascicular involvement of the nerve complexes are involved. And as you rightly said, it's the 9, it's a 10. With 9, we really do not know. It's definitely the 10. There is the sympathetic tract, there is the cerebellar involvement, and there is the fifth nerve nuclei involvement, as well as the spinal tract nuclei, which is involved, which all points to the involvement of the lateral medulla. All these conglomerate in the lateral medulla, and most likely due to what?
Because of the patient is having all the vascular risk factors, sir.
Yeah. Which territory do you want to put it?
I would like to left posterior inferior cerebellar artery or vertebral artery can be the causative or vertebral artery. Sir.
So it's either the posterior inferior cerebellar artery or the vertebral artery, which could be the reason for this.
No. Okay, sir. Okay,
sir. Very nice. Thank you, Dr. Ashwin. And
welcome, sir. Welcome, sir.
Can I have the next slide? Professor Raman, sir?
Yeah, sir. Can I just go to the first slide, sir, in that order which has been sent, or how do you want to proceed, sir?
If you have the list, whatever you want to display, I can discuss.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Dr. Ashwin. I think Dr. Lavanya, postgraduate resident, will be actually trying to actually answer, sir, for the imaging findings.
Yes, sir. Sir, good morning, sir. I'm Dr. Lavanya. These are MRI images. On the left side, we have T2 axial. On the right side, T2 flare MRI images. It is a coronal section images. Very images good. Showed hyper intensity in bilateral medial temporal regions, sir.
Very good. Okay.
Yes, sir. That's it.
So, what is your differential diagnosis for this?
Sir, we can go.
Of course, I am not providing you with the history here.
Yes, sir.
So, if I any have a history, I would ask directly the diagnosis. Here you have a T2 axial and a T2 coronal flare.
Yes,
and
sir.
And both these, can I use?
For encephalitis.
Are you able to see my cursor?
Sir, sorry, sir.
Are you able to see the cursor?
No, sir. Encephalitis, infective causes, encephalitis.
Okay. What encephalitis really leads to the involvement of the hippocampus and the amygdala, the parahippocampal gyrus?
Herpes simplex, sir.
Very good. Okay. Would you like to offer any other differential diagnosis for this image? Just one or two. Say there is a diffusion restriction.
Yes, sir.
Probably a focal status, which is a complex partial seizure of the temporal origin or the mesial temporal origin that is producing a status, can also produce a bilateral hippocampal hyperintensity. The other possibility is it could be a limbic encephalitis. That's the new kid of the block. So whenever you have a young lady who is presenting to you with the altered behavior, you have ruled out HSV encephalitis, but you understand that her altered behavior is continuing and you are seeing some threats in the EEG and the CSF is not contributory. You think of something.
Okay.
What it could be? It could be something like a limbic encephalitis, like the voltage-gated potassium channel, VGKC encephalitis, which is one of the newer entities that which is one of the entities that you have to keep in your mind when you're thinking of a young person who is coming with an acute onset altered behavior. Next slide. Thank you.
Sorry to interrupt you. Do you want to try once sharing the slide, because it would be easier for you to explain to the students, particularly in imaging. Is it okay, sir? You want to try?
Yes, I'll try again.
Yeah, I'll just stop sharing, sir, because the students wanted some basic reading. So they just could show that, like, that would be great, sir. So just I'm stop sharing.
No problem. Is it visible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
It's moving, sir. Now, no. You can click on the slide there.
I'll do it.
Yes, sir.
Is that okay?
Yes, sir. This is fine, sir.
All right. Okay.
Should we restrict to that that 5-1, sir?
Definitely, sir. Definitely.
Sure, sir. I'll just tell the slide number alone, sir, so that like.
No. I have the slide. I have actually edited it.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, sir. Done.
Yes. Can I have the discussion? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Sir, do you want to explain the previous one?
Shall I explain and go on?
Yes, sir. Can you please explain the previous one, sir?
This is the next slide. Here I have a T2 coronal flare. And in this, I'll show you a particular finding. You compare the hippocampus on the left to the hippocampus on the right. Can I have the discussion on board also? Just have it. Which do you think is larger, Dr. Lavanya, this one or this one? The right or the left? Which do you think is large, this one or this one, the right or the left?
Right side.
This is right.
Right side.
This is larger. Which is smaller? The left one is smaller. So
here, a
T2 flare image where the hippocampus is shrunken on the left side. And it is having a hyper-intense signal. Can you see that? So,
yes, sir. Hyper.
The right, the left is shrunken, and there is a hyper-intense signal, which suggests that this is a case of a mesial temporal
sclerosis.
Okay, yes. There is a hippocampal atrophy, and there is a hippocampal hyper-intensity. This is one of the most important causes for drug-refractory epilepsy world over, almost 60 to 70% of cases of drug refractory epilepsy would be having something like a mesial temporal sclerosis.
Yes, sir.
That is a hippocampal atrophy. Now I come to the next slide on this right, on my right side. So you see a hippocampus here, and you see a hippocampus here. And this hippocampus, which do you think is large? The right one or the left one?
Left one, sir.
Yeah, very good. So the left one is large, and which do you think is hyperintense, the right one or the left one?
Hyperintense.
Hyperintense. That is which is brighter, right one or the left one?
The left one, sir.
Very nice. So here you have a hippocampus which is enlarged. You have a parahippocampus and the hippocampus which are brighter. And the subcortex also appears to be brighter. So this is a case of a focal cortical dysplasia of the hippocampus and the parahippocampal gyrus, which is also a very important cause of a drug refractory epilepsy. All right.
Yes, sir.
Now I come to the same location. This is a 70-year-old gentleman. He is having frequent forgetfulness. And can you see something and tell me?
Yes, sir. First two images.
Just attempt. I will discuss with you. Okay. You just have a comment on the hippocampus alone, here and here. So I showed you a normal hippocampus. I showed you a volume loss hippocampus. I showed you a volume which is larger hippocampus. But here I am showing you again a bilateral shrunken hippocampus.
Can significant atrophy, sir.
Very good.
Atrophy. Yes, sir.
Very good. So there is a significant atrophy which is bilateral in an elderly gentleman. This is a classic feature of Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's.
So there you see. So I'm showing you the same hippocampus across ages, across different spectra, but the same radiological images having different diagnoses. The next. Would you like to attempt something in this? I'll help you out.
Yes, sir.
The first one. CT image. The first one.
Yes, sir. CT
image.
What you see? It's a CT section. CT shows hyperdensity lesion in left frontotemporal region, and has contusion with the mass effect. There was midline shift towards right, sir.
Excellent, doctor. Excellent. That's the perfect description. So you see here, there is a hyperintense signal which extends from the frontal to the temporal region, associated with contusions seen in the frontal region as well as slightly in the temporal region, associated with a mass effect, that is edema, and there is a midline shift.
Yes, sir.
So what is your opinion on this?
Sir,
So this is an acute subdural hematoma with contusions seen in the parenchyma, and there is a midline shift. So there is a pressure effect. Now come to the second one.
It's diffuse cerebral edema,
You know, you just first always attempt to tell in radiological discussion which cut you are viewing. That's the first step. Which image, whether it's a CT or MRI, cut, which level, then you describe what you see, and then you come to a conclusion.
Yes, sir. It is a CT image.
Coronal. An axial or a coronal? This is axial.
Axial.
Very good. Axial cut. Very good. Yeah. It's almost in the. It's near the convexity.
Convexity.
Yes. It's above the ventricular level. So probably in the cortical or in the coronal radial level. Okay. Then.
Yes,
so what do you see? See the normal side. This is the normal side. What do you describe? You see the normal gray and white. And convolutions, and you see the CSF space.
Yes, sir.
What do you see on the left here? Do you see this convolutions? Do you see the CSF space in between the gyroid?
No, sir.
No.
It is not compressed.
Why is it compressed? Is it getting compressed from within or without? It's getting compressed from without. There's something. Can you see a line here? Can you see a demarcation here in this point? So that is the demarcation between the parenchyma and the subdural space. So you see here an entire subdural collection which is seen over the parietal and frontal convexity. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
But compared to this brightness, how is this? This is seems to be more iso-dense. So anything that any blood which is acute is hyperdense. But anything that is taking time off loses its density and becomes iso-dense. So this is a case of a subacute subdural hemorrhage.
Okay,
this is one of the commonest mimickers for neurobehavioral manifestations. For example, recently I saw a patient who didn't have food intake, that's all, for the past 15 days. And he was behaving somewhat abnormally. When we did a CT, we found a subacute subdural. So subtle faults, patients being on minimal antiplatelets, neurobehavioral suspect, short term, which is a subacute, kindly suspect a subdural. Now come to the third image. Can you describe this?
Sir, we can see the hypodense lesion.
No, first to the cut. First to the cut. Always go in order in an exam. First to the cut. Is it a CT or MRI?
CT scan, CT image, sir.
Is it axial or coronal?
Coronal, sir.
Coronal?
No, sir.
Axial.
Axial, sir.
Very good. Okay. More near axial. The convexity. Near the convexity. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
That's the site. Yes, third. Sir. What do you see now?
Hypodense.
Normal sulci gyri pattern here in the parenchyma. As I see, can you see the cursor?
Yes, sir. Can you
see the cursor? Yeah. I'm showing the sulci. Can you see the sulcal spaces here?
No,
can
sir.
Can you see the gyri independently here?
No, sir.
No. So it seems to be compressed. It is compressed from within or without? It's compressed from without. That's
without. Without. Yes, sir.
From outside. Is it one side or both sides?
Both sides, sir.
Both sides. Very good. Yeah, what is the brightness of that compression? Is it hypo, iso, or
hypodense, sir.
This is hypo.
Yes, sir. Hypodense.
You agree this? Now, yes, this is sir. Brighter or this is brighter? This is brighter.
This is
iso. So, hypodense. This is slightly hyperdense. Okay. So, you see a mixture of, this is an acute on chronic subdural. Can you understand? This is the chronic subdural. This is an acute subdural.
Okay, sir.
Are you able to visualize? So I'm showing a hyperdense, then an isodense, and a mixture. And why I'm highlighting this point is, this subdural would have happened much longer, and top of it, another leak has happened, and this is causing a chronic, acute or chronic subdural hemorrhage. Okay, we'll go to the next one. Can you just describe? I'll be there. I mean, in this attempt.
Sir, it is a CT image.
Very
CT
good.
Reveals hypodensity.
Axial cut.
Hypodensity in the region of right coronoradiata and frontotemporal parietal region with mass effect and midline shift towards left, sir.
Excellent. Okay. Now I'm going into the MRI.
MRI. Oh. Yes, sir. The first image is T2 weighted image. Second one is ADC, that is apparent diffusion coefficient. Okay. Third one is diffusion weighted image. Fourth one is T2 flare. Hmm. Fifth one is MRA, sir.
Okay, very good. Okay. Now describe each one by one. Now leave this one alone.
Okay,
describe
sir.
This and this.
In ADC, there is a dark signal is seen, sir, which is corresponding to bright signal in diffusion-weighted images. That indicates diffusion restriction, sir.
Very good. Very good. Excellent. So, there is a diffusion restriction. And yes, what do you see in the MR angiogram? You
MR
see the MCA territory well-defined on
sir.
The left side. But here...
It's not visualized on right side, sir.
Excellent.
M1 segment is also cut off.
Okay. So, in the CT, I have shown you images of a right MCA territory infarct, which shows hypodensity with the mass effect. And the same we are confirming in the MRI, which shows a diffusion restriction. And in the MR angiography, there seems to be a attenuation of vasculature on the right side. So, it suggests a right MCA territory. In fact,
okay. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now this is the last one. Yes, so that's the image.
Yes, sir. That is a T2 MRI image. It's a ring enhancing lesion is seen in right.
T2 MRI.
T2 MRI image.
MRI image. Okay.
Reveals hypo-intense lesion with surrounding hyper intensity in right cerebral hemisphere with mass effects. And also there is compression with fourth ventricle is also seen.
Very good.
And flare in next second one, another ring lesion, ring enhancing lesion,
it's a flare, there is no contrast. So there is no question of enhancement. So you have,
hypo intensity lesion. Yes, sir.
It's a ring shaped lesion. You can see
In lesion in parietal region and right cerebral hemisphere, sir.
Okay, with the surrounding edema.
Yes, sir, with surrounding edema. Okay.
What do you see in the third one?
Third one, again, ring lesion, sir. No,
just tell me first the cut, in order.
Sir, T2 MRI, sir.
No, this is T1 contrast.
Contrast. Yes, sir. So third one is contrast. Yes,
contrast
sir.
Image. Yes. It's an axial one.
Yes, sir.
And it's the going through the cerebellum.
Yes,
and
sir.
And here, ring enhancing lesion. So this is a ring enhancing lesion.
Yes, right? Sir.
So what is your diagnosis?
Probably.
I'll take you to the diagnosis. Whenever you see a hypo-intense ring.
Yes, sir.
The T2, the differentials become very narrow. It straight away tells you that this is likely to be a tuberculoma. Understand?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because in any of the other T2 weighted images, the central core would become hyperintensive. For example, in a neurocystis, that's the commonest differential that we have to entertain. Tuberculoma versus a neurocystis versus.
Yes, sir.
The points in favor of a tuberculoma are the size.
Yes, sir.
Usually, it is less than two centimeter is a neurocystic core. More than that is a tuberculoma. The central core is hypo-intense. There's a gross edema. There are multiple lesions. And it's a ring enhancement, suggesting the possibility of a tuberculoma. All right. Thank you very much. That's a nice discussion that we had. And shall I go on to the EEG, sir?
Yes, sir. Actually, students just wanted some basic, so CT, what is like an NRI, just the basic they wanted, sir. But anyway, like we will proceed, sir, actually. They just are asking for like...
You want me to deliberate more MRIs? I have more MRIs to show.
No, sir. They just wanted just some basic understanding of how to read a CT and MRI.
But
due to lack of time, we will just progress, sir. We will proceed, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay. I mean... if you want, I have another slide or I can show you, how to go through.
Yes, sir. Maybe one CT and one MRI, we'll be making them understand, how to just...
Yes. All right, sir. All right. I'll finish the EEG and I'll come back to that, sir.
Yes, Thank you, sir.
Okay, now coming to the EEG segment, would someone read it or shall I go through it, sir?
Sir, it would be better if you kindly explain, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Now, coming to the EEG reading, that's a class by itself. And in the given time, I'll try to tell you in an exam, how do you read an EEG? So, the first thing is always in an EEG is about the settings. I have not kept the settings in this. The settings are the low frequency filter, the high frequency filter, the kind of montage, the paper speed. This is what you should remark first. The next point that you have to tell is the montage. This is called as a double banana montage. That is FP1 to F3, F3 to C3, C3 to P3, and P3 to O1. The other type of reading will be an average montage or referential montage, where everything will be connected to a common average or a common referential point. So this is a double banana montage, and this shows a normal background. This shows a normal background. Why I am saying it's a normal background is because you have a significant posterior dominant alpha. How do I say it is an alpha? Now, between this line and this line, it is 1 second. In this 1 second, the number of peaks that you see are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So a normal alpha is between 9 to 13 hertz. So here you see 9 peaks in a single second, so 9 cycles per second are a normal alpha rhythm in a double banana montage. Okay. Now, the same alpha can be seen in an alpha coma also. That is, a patient who is comatose also can have an alpha rhythm. But so, the most important feature of an alpha is to know whether the alpha is reactive or not. How do I know it is reactive or not? I do a second procedure called as eye opening and an eye closure. So when I open the eye, you see a normal alpha there. But do you see this region? The alpha is suppressed out. Once my eyes are closed, the alpha comes back again. So this is called as reactivity. So you see, the alpha which is there before the eye opening comes back after the eye is closed. So this is the normal reactivity of an alpha rhythm. So here is a normal alpha. The next thing in regard to alpha is, here you see a normal alpha rhythm. Here you can count once again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So there's a normal background alpha. But once I start counting for the mental arithmetic, the alpha gets suppressed up. So you see the alpha is not there here. So this is called as, once again, a reactivity of alpha. So the most important point what I'm trying to emphasize here is, it's not only the cycles per second or the number of upstrokes that you see, but the reactivity of the upstroke is the most important point to call it an alpha. Here the mental arithmetic ends and you get an alpha again. Now I'll take you through stages of sleep. So this is a average monitor, what I was referring to here, FP1. So when they display an EEG like this, the first thing that you have to like say, this is a common average. This is average. Every lead is connected to an average. And you can see that it's 30 millimeter per second. And the low cut filter is 0.3. The high cut filter is 70 hertz. And the sensitivity is at 70 microvolts per second. Okay. What I'm taking you through is, this is a normal alpha. Can you see once again? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So in 1 second, you see 10 upstrokes. But this alpha suddenly disappears out and again returns. So this is called as alpha dropout. So when a patient moves from a wakeful state to a sleepy state, there is an alpha dropout. So that is the first stage of sleep. The next thing that you see is, that's what I'm trying to explain here. The next thing that you see in the sleep is, this phenomenon is called as a phase reversal. This is a double banana montage, once again, where the leads are interconnected and you see a downstroke here and an upstroke here in F3, C3 and C3, P3. So this is called as phase reversal. This phase reversal that is seen across C3, C4 and CZ is called as the vertex wave. So as you would have read earlier, vertex wave is one of the first stages of sleep. So I am tracing you from wakeful stage to a sleep stage. The wakeful stage, we saw an alpha. The alpha was reactive. The alpha was reactive to mental arithmetic. Then there was an alpha which is getting dropped out. Then you see the appearance of a vertex wave, which says that there is a stage one of sleep that is happening. Now, this is another finding that generally they may ask you. This is a double banana montage. And here, you see some 12 hertz spindle-like structure. This is called as the sleep spindle. The alpha is generally seen in the posterior leads, that is in P4, O2 and P3, O1. But in the central leads, when you have a 12 to 14 hertz, this is called as the sleep spindle. So a vertex wave with the sleep spindle tells that the patient has entered into stage 2 of sleep. And then this is the third point to tell, which is a stage 2 of sleep. This is called as the K-complex, which you have read in your textbooks. This is the K-complex. So K-complex is nothing but a vertex with a spindle that is mixed together. A vertex and a spindle together is called as a K-complex. So once again, I'm taking you through the stages. There is a normal alpha. The alpha is reactive. The alpha is reactive to mental arithmetic. Then the alpha drops out, which says the patient is drowsy. Then sleep spindles, vertex, and K complexes appear, which stay. It's a stage 2 of sleep. Okay. Now I come to the next important point in EEG. That is what is called as hyperventilation. This is one of the most important things that we do in an EEG monitoring. That is, we ask the patient to take deep breaths for around 3 minutes, and with a specific idea. Here you see a good alpha which is seen, which is a double banana montage with the normal settings, and there is a alpha. But as you go, you see, you count the number of upstrokes that are between 1 second, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So from alpha is 9 to 13 hertz, but here you see a theta rhythm. So as the patient is hyperventilating, the EEG becomes slower and slower. It becomes slower and slower. And this is, look at the number of spikes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that's all. So patient has gone into a theta run. This is we call as a frontal slowing due to a hyperventilation. So the classic feature of hyperventilation is the EEG becomes slow. The EEG becomes slow. Now, why do we need to do a hyperventilation is because one of the very important diagnoses we can make in hyperventilation. Here you see, this is the patient is hyper, this is a double banana montage once again, and you have the settings here. The patient is hyperventilating and tapping, and suddenly you see a burst. This is a burst. This is, if you count in 1 second, it is dart and dome, 3 dart and domes are seen. Okay, can you see this? 1, 2, 3, or maybe 2.5 to 3. Okay, so this is the classic 3 hertz spike, which is seen in absence seizure. So how do you describe it in an exam? There is an abrupt onset, there is an abrupt offset of a generalized 3 hertz rhythm. This is classic feature of childhood absence epilepsy. So you see a patient is hyperventilating, sudden burst, 1, 2, 3 within no second, 3 hertz dart and dome pattern, which is generalized, and it goes on, and there is a abrupt offset. So suggestive of a childhood absence epilepsy. Okay, now I come to the most important interface between neurologists and psychiatrists. The area of complex partial seizures and especially of temporal lobe epilepsy. Here you will see once again what is called as a double banana montage. And in this double banana montage, you see something here. This is called as the, see, one point I would like to say, the odd numbers say it is left, the even numbers say it is right. So this is the temporal lobe, this is the temporal chain, sorry. And here you have the even numbers. So it's the right temporal. The right temporal region, you see here a phenomenon what is called as the phase reversal. That is, a phase reversal is one where there is a downstroke and an upstroke. And in the adjacent lead, there is an upstroke. So there is a field. This is called as a phase reversal. This phase reversal is seen across F8. So this is called as an anterior temporal spike. This is an anterior temporal spike, which is classically seen in complex partial seizures of temporal origin and very classically seen in right mesial temporal sclerosis, what we were discussing earlier. And here again, you see for yourself, this is the even number and this is the temporal chain. The temporal chain, you see a downstroke, an upstroke, an upstroke, and an upstroke. So this is a field. So across T1, there is a phase reversal. Can you see this point? The discussant, are you clear with this particular point? Because this is one of the most important points. This is called as the phase reversal. F7T1, this is negative. This is positive, sorry. This is negative and there is a field. So there is a T1 spike. Can you see? An average, this is, I have brought in the average motor, then you see an F7T1 spike, which is called as a left anterior temporal spike, which is classically seen in a complex partial seizures of temporal origin. One of the prototype is a mesial temporal sclerosis. Okay. I wouldn't wish to confuse you any further. Once again, I am showing you a temporal chain. The even numbers are there, so it's called a right temporal chain. And in the right temporal chain, you see a spike in T4, T6 and T6O2, which is suggestive of a right posterior temporal spike. This is also a complex partial seizures of temporal origin, but it is slightly posterior. You generally don't see this in a mesial temporal sclerosis. So a note on temporal IEDs. So we call it anterior when the phase reversal is across F7, F8 and T1, T2. Mid when the phase reversal is across T3, T4. And posterior when it is across T5 and T6. Okay, this is going to be my final slide with regard to the EEG. This is another prototype which we generally see, especially in patients who are alcoholic. And here you see what we describe as it's an average montage as the Indian Peninsula. Can you see this? Does it look like an Indian Peninsula? Somewhat. So this is an upstroke, a downstroke and an upstroke. So across. So this is a classic triphasic wave. It's a classic triphasic wave which we see in hepatic encephalopathies, commonly in alcoholics. And it's generally generalized. It's bilaterally synchronous symmetric at 1.5 to 2.5 hertz. It is frontally dominant. There's a background generalized slowing or loss of alpha. And the common etiologies are hepatic, hypoxic, uremic, Hashimoto's, and hyponatremia, etc. Raman sir?
Yes, sir. I'm sorry. Sir. They just have some few queries, sir.
N number of queries, sir. No?
Yes, sir. I understand, sir. This is itself a workshop by its nature, because like imaging and EEG, it's like you can conduct a workshop, sir, because we really would love to learn from you. One thing that the student has asked is, can you please explain phase reversal? And
I will put it across like this. The easiest way to understand a phase reversal is to understand the electrophysiology in phase reversal. So each lead is either positive or negative. It's a relative term. Okay, sir. So this is how my teacher taught me. Positive to negative or negative to positive. That's how the current flows. So positive to negative is down. The stroke goes down. So FP2 is positive, F8 is negative. Negative to positive, the stroke goes up. So F8 is negative, T4 is positive. So in this combination of FP2, F8, F8, T4, the maximum electronegativity is seen in F8. So negative, positive to negative, and negative to positive. So wherever you see F8 becomes negative. So there is a downstroke and there is an upstroke. So that is the phase reversal. And whenever the phase reversal is there, the negativity extends to the adjoining lead. And so there is a field. So the T4, T6 goes up. So if you view this in an average montage, this will be seen as a spike in F8. Or it will have the maximum amplitude in F8. So what you mean by phase reversal is, it's the source of maximum electronegativity. So am I clear, or
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. The people wanted the explanation is like how to differentiate T1, T2, flat and diffusion weighted images on MRI.
Okay. I'll go to this particular one, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is a T2 weighted segment. In a T2 weighted segment, the easiest way to, and this is a flare. Of course, I'm not showing the axial one, but this is the flare. How do you differentiate? The presence of CSF is T2. The absence of CSF is flare.
Okay, sir.
The simplest way, sir. If you see the CSF as bright, it is T2. Especially in here, the cortex will be white and the gray will be gray, dark. In both, the same will be there. But if the CSF is present, or this whitish one, which is seen here, outside is the CSF. But here you don't have that. So that, what is flare is, that CSF is suppressed is what is called as flare. Fluid attenuation of an inversion recovery. That's the fluid gets attenuated. So okay. The fluid that you see here gets attenuated here. Am I clear, sir?
Yes, sir.
In the sulcus, there it's not white. But yes, here, sir. The sulcus is white.
Yes, sir.
So this suppression is called as flare.
Okay.
And so once again here, can you see the CSF here, sir?
Yes, sir.
But here, do you see any CSF in the sulcus space? There is no CSF. So that is the differentiation between T2 and flare.
Okay, sir. Sure. So we'll have the last one, because they just repeatedly asking this only. So how to read an MRI? Can you just give us overview?
All right, sir. I mean, that's a separate topic.
Yes, sir. I understand, sir. I've told them also, sir. Like, it is a big topic. So, whatever feasible you can say, sir, like that we find out. So,
I mean, in the MRI, what are the sequences that we look at are T1, T2, flare, diffusion, ADC, and SWI images. And the contrast. This is what forms the normal patterns. Okay, for example, I'll go to the stroke once again. In the stroke, what we look at is in T2, there will be a hyper intense signal. That is, it will become bright. So this is a T2 weighted image, which is an axial section, but this is bright. Can you see?
Yes, sir.
Compared to this is bright.
Yes, sir.
So this is called as T2 hyperintense signal. The same hyperintense signal would also be seen in a flare. So for example, I'll take you in a stroke. In a stroke, there is an MCA territory infarct. The blood supply gets cut. So what you will be seeing is the T1, there will be hypointense signal. The T2 will become bright. The flare also becomes bright.
Okay.
In the same way, this is not the consequent image of this diffusion, but the diffusion also will become bright.
Okay.
So, but the corresponding ADC images will become dark, which suggests that it is an acute infarct. Suppose if it is a chronic infarct, you will have the same T2 which is bright, the flare also will be bright, but the sulcal spaces will become widened because of atrophy. And the diffusion will not show any brightness. And the ADC also will not show much of a darkness.
Okay.
So that is called as a chronic infarct. So I'll come to tuberculoma as an example. So in a tuberculoma, here you have you see it is a T2 cut. And here you see a CSF.
Yes, sir.
So in a T2 cut, the CSF will be seen. It will not be suppressed. But in a flare, it will be suppressed.
Yes, sir.
And here, what you look here is a T2 high. You have to just keep describing. You see a T2 hypointense central signal, followed by a small ring, followed by a hyperintensity. So here, this suggests that this is a ring or a rounded lesion, which is a hypointense lesion in T2. But in the same, in the flare, the CSF gets suppressed out completely.
Yes.
Completely gets suppressed out. But there will not be much changes in the interval between T2 and flare. Why you need a flare is because when the CSF is adjoining, sometimes you may not be able to delineate the lesion, whether there is a lesion or not. But when it is suppressed, it becomes more clear. So can you see, this is clear or this is clear? This seems to be more clearer than this. That's the understanding.
Yes, sir.
Now, in a contrast, what we try to see is whether that particular lesion gets enhanced. That is the reason why we apply a contrast. So, is there a breakdown in the blood-brain barrier and whether the contrast is able to diffuse? And based on the patterns that you see, you try to come to a differential. That is based on contrast.
Yes, sir.
But, I mean, without further images, if I talk theory, they may not be able to understand.
So, that's fine, sir. Sure, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. I think, we learned a lot. I think, it was very systematic and very clear explanation, sir. For a psychiatric perspective, I think students, they would have definitely benefited from your understanding of both clinical case scenarios, EEG and CT, sir. And they will have a lot of questions because I think, as you said, it requires a lot of time to explain. Probably they'll have to go and read and brush up their basics and all these things so that they will understand. So, and I sincerely thank you, sir, for your valuable time. And amidst your hectic schedule and other personal commitments, we really thank you, sir. And we are really looking forward to some good workshop so that we learn a lot as well, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Professor Raman sir. Thank you, Dr. Shanti Nambi, madam.